Hello everyone, my name is Abhishek Buxi. I am working as Assistant Professor in the Department of Zoology, Mahatma Gandhi Government Arts College, Mahe, Union Territory of Puducherry, India. This is my second video lecture in this series, Lectures of Zoology. In my previous video lecture, I have discussed the details of anatomy of excretory system of rabbit, and in this present video lecture, I am going to continue the same topic, explaining the physiology of excretion in rabbit, Oryctolagus cuniculus. So, in my previous lecture, I have discussed in detail with the structural organization of excretory system of rabbit. In this lecture, I will discuss the process of urine formation, the physiology of excretion in rabbit. In order to understand the structural organization of rabbit excretory system, please go through my previous video, Excretion, Excretory System of Rabbit, Part 1. Formation of urine in rabbit begins with the filtration of blood in the filtration units of kidney known as uriniferous tubules or nephron. The entire process of urine formation or the processivity of blood filtration and generation of urine can be divided into three major steps. The first step, in which the blood get filtered and the waste is collected in the convoluted tubule of nephron. The second part, where all the useful material which got filtered along the waste is needed to be taken back in the body. And the third step is release of those toxic substances or waste material from the blood into the filtrate or waste excretory fluid, which was not possible to filter out in the Malthusian capsule of nephron. These three steps of excretion of any mammalian kidney are referred as ultrafiltration, selective or tubular reabsorption, and tubular secretion. So let's begin our discussion on the physiology or process of excretion in rabbit. The nitrogenous waste products of metabolism in rabbit are generally urea. As I have discussed in my previous lecture also, all the mammals are ureotelic, so do rabbits, which is synthesized in liver from amino acids by a cyclic chain of reactions. The urea is then carried through the blood into the kidney, where it is eliminated with the urine. Every cell and tissue of the body, they generate metabolic waste, and most of these wastes are generated in the form of nitrogenous material. However, urea is not synthesized in each and every cell or tissue of the body. All these nitrogenous wastes are released by the individual cells into their tissue fluid, from where they diffuse into the passing blood. That blood brings all these different forms of nitrogenous waste, maybe in the form of ammonia or ammonic acid or the ammonium nitrate or different forms of salts of the nitrogenous material, and then they get processed by the hepatic cells, by the liver cells, by different chemical reactions, metabolic reactions, and they get converted. All these nitrogenous waste get converted into urea. The primary processes are deaminations and transaminations, and with the help of a few specific amino acids, these nitrogenous waste are converted into removable form, that is urea, in the hepatocytes, in the liver cells of rabbit body. Now, from there, this urea is again transferred to the passing blood of the liver, and from there, the blood is taken or to the kidneys, where they are carrying the removable form of nitrogenous waste, urea, and this urea get filtered in the uriniferous tubules or nephrons of rabbit kidney. Urine formation in kidneys occur by the three different steps which I mentioned just before: ultrafiltration, selective reabsorption, and tubular secretion. The process of ultrafiltration takes place within the Malthusian capsule, rather within by the glomerulus, by the blood capillaries network known as glomerulus, enclosed within the Bowman's capsule. In order to know the structure detail of the glomerulus and Bowman's capsule, please refer to my previous video lecture. The blood which is coming under the high pressure in the glomerulus through the afferent renal arteriole, whose diameter is greater than that of the efferent arteriole, causes ultrafiltration through the lumen of blood capillaries. The wall of the blood capillaries are made up of a single cell endothelial layer, and they are permeable enough under high pressure to pass out almost all fluid material, not 100%, majority of the fluid part of the blood, and almost everything which is solubilized in the blood plasma. However, the wall of these blood capillaries are not perforated, or they are not that large in size that will allow passing of any blood corpuscles, any blood cell. In fact, none of the larger proteins or salts complexes, they could not cross this capillary wall barrier. So due to the ultrafiltration, the dissolved substances of the blood, for example urea, the salts of sodium and potassium, small sugar molecules like glucose, and maximum amount of water, they get filtered and get collected in the lumen of the cup of Bowman's capsule. The inner layer of the Bowman's capsule cell, the Bowman's capsule inner cavity cellular layer, made up of flat squamous epithelial cells, they also are highly permeable, and they allow the passing of these filtrate into the lumen of Bowman's capsule. If you look at the diagram, this diagram is representing the afferent arteriole, this is the efferent arteriole, and if you look closely, you can see the larger structures, which are represented with the help of the green color larger spherical structures, they are not passing through the blood capillaries. Only the small soluble structures, which are represented with the help of blue or violet color circular structures, they are getting filtered out from the capillaries to the lumen of Bowman's capsule, and from the lumen of the Bowman's capsule into the tubular structure of the Bowman's capsule. This entire process is purely physical, and it does not involve any active transportation or any biological process as such. No transporter proteins, no energy is used in the entire process of ultrafiltration. It is because of the pressure difference in the afferent arteriole and efferent arteriole, because the diameter is larger in the afferent, so the blood, when it enters from the afferent arteriole into the capillaries, because of the sudden decrease in the diameter, the blood pressure enormously enhances in these capillaries, and under that high blood pressure, all the fluid portion along with the solubilized material get filtered and enters into first lumen of Bowman's capsule and subsequently into the convoluted tubule. The blood contains many blood cells like WBCs, RBCs, blood platelets, but they are quite large structures and they cannot pass through the tiny porous wall of blood capillaries. Even all the blood proteins like albumin and globulins, they do not get filtered or pass through the capillary walls. Fat molecules, they all remain and they pass along the efferent arteriole outside the glomerular capillaries. This entire process is known as ultrafiltration. The filtrate which is collected in the Bowman's capsule is known as glomerular or capsular filtrate. Sometimes these are also, this is also referred as the primary filtrate. The remaining blood constituents, they pass into the efferent arteriole. And as I mentioned earlier, this entire process is simply a physical process. The second step of urine formation is selective or tubular reabsorption. As we have seen in the previous diagram, almost all solubilized material of the blood gets filtered along the urea and the waste material. Not all the things which get filtered in the Bowman's capsule are waste products. For example, water. It is an essential ingredient of the body, and the amount of water which get filtered in the Bowman's capsule, it is enormously large. And if an individual will lose that much amount of water, that rabbit, that individual will die. So almost the whole filtrate which is generated, almost 75% to 90% of the water which is generated in the glomerular filtrate are reabsorbed. Similarly, those molecules which are needed by the body, for example, like glucose, many amino acids, they get filtered out. Important salt molecules which get filtered out, they all are required by the body and they are not the waste products which are needed to be removed from the body. Hence, before the final removal of this filtrate from the convoluted tubule, as this filtrate passes through the convoluted tubule length, all the important and required material of the body, they get reabsorbed in the process. So the glomerular filtrate contains some useful substances like water, glucose, amino acids, and many salts. And these useful substances are reabsorbed primarily in the first part of the convoluted tubule, what is known as the proximal convoluted tubule. We have already discussed the detail of the structure of convoluted tubule and nephrons in my previous video lecture. The absorbed substances then pass into the blood circulation through the capillaries of the efferent arterioles found around the convoluted tubule, which finally joins to form the renal venules. In order to understand the structural organization, please go through my previous first lecture of excretion in excretory system in rabbit part 1. Now, once this filtrate started passing through the proximal convoluted tubule, all important solid materials which are solubilized in the filtrate like glucose, salts, amino acids, they first, these molecules, they get absorbed through the wall of the proximal convoluted tubule with the help of active specific protein transporters. And these protein transporters then transfer these reabsorbed molecules into capillary networks available just outside them, which has originated. These capillaries have originated from the efferent arteriole. Hence, basically, by this selective reabsorption, all these essential materials, they are transferred back from the filtrate to the same blood from where they have been taken. The maximum water reabsorption takes place in the second part of the convoluted tubule, which is known as loop of Henle. However, almost negligible amount of or no amount of water reabsorption takes place in the DCT of rabbit nephrons. Glucose, amino acids, and yes, some amount of urea also get reabsorbed in the PCT. Whereas chloride and bicarbonates of sodiums are reabsorbed in the distal convoluted tubules mainly. Some amount may also get reabsorbed in the proximal convoluted tubule. But most of the urea and water are reabsorbed by the passive diffusion. As I mentioned earlier, that the first thing which get reabsorbed are the solute dissolved materials like the glucose, amino acids, salts, and other things. Once these materials started getting removed from the filtrate and actively getting transferred to the outside capillaries, the concentration of blood in these external capillaries, they started increasing. And whereas the concentration of the filtrate within the lumen of convoluted tubule start decreasing. As a result, the water start diffusing without use of any energy. Water start diffusing and passively it get transferred from the lumen of convoluted tubule to the surrounding capillaries. Amino acids, salts, and sugars, they are all reabsorbed by active transportation. Thus, as the glomerular filtrate passes through the convoluted tubule, the useful substances are reabsorbed and the concentration of waste products, including urea, increases in this filtrate. The third step is tubular secretion. The tubular secretion process takes place at the last part of convoluted tubule of nephron, that is in the distal convoluted tubule. Tubular secretion is basically needed for the removal of those molecules which cannot be filtered in the glomerulus. As I have mentioned earlier, the entire process of ultrafiltration is a physical process. There is no energy or no specific transporter proteins are involved. However, there are many molecules which are needed to be removed from the blood, which may be larger in size. For example, like the antibiotics which we consume, they are needed to be removed. Sometimes some complex protein molecules are there which are broken or damaged and they are needed to be removed from the blood. But as these molecules are quite large in size, they cannot pass through the small pores of glomerular capillaries, or neither they can pass through the Bowman's capsule lumen. Hence, all these unwanted waste material still remain in the blood, which comes out through the efferent arteriole. However, as soon as the blood capillaries comes out of the glomerulus as efferent arteriole, it again bifurcates and divides multiple times to form capillaries around the convoluted tubules. And here, these capillaries, when come in close contact with the distal convoluted tubule, with the help of specific transporter proteins, these large waste molecules are actively transported or transferred from these efferent arteriole capillaries to the distal convoluted tubule. That means all the waste which cannot be filtered because of their larger size are actively transferred or secreted into the distal convoluted tubule to be added in the filtrate, which is processed after selective reabsorption and is passing through the distal convoluted tubule. So in this tubular secretion process, some substances like remnant urea, creatine, creatinine, ammonia, hydrogen potassium ions, and various drugs, they are secreted into the lumen of tubule
from the efferent capillaries surrounding the tubules. After tubular secretion, the substance which is left in the tubule at the end of the convoluted tubule, which is now about to enter the collecting duct, is rich in excretory wastes, and now we call this processed filtrate as urine, which contains nearly 95% water, 2% urea, 6% calcium and sodium chlorides, and some uric acid, creatinine, ammonia, etc. This fluid also contains a pigment known as urochrome, which is generated by the breakdown of hemoglobin. It is this urochrome which provides the characteristic pale yellow color to the urine. The urine thus formed passes into the collecting tubule, and through the collecting tubule it enters into the pelvis, and from the pelvis it passes through the ureter and get finally collected in the urinary bladder. And once the urinary bladder fills, it gives a sensation for micturition or passing out of urine to the exterior, and rabbit passes that urine to the external world. The bladder contracts and forces the urine outside through the urinogenital canal or urethra through the urinogenital aperture. This diagram is a representation of the entire process of urine formation in rabbit. This is for illustration and easy understanding. Hence, the convoluted tubule has been extended to explain the different processes which are carried out throughout the urine formation. The first process is glomerular filtration, which takes place, the ultrafiltration, which takes place in the glomerulus and the Bowman's capsule, the Malthusian capsule portion, due to the high blood pressure, which you can see here, the movement of substances from the blood within the glomerulus into the capsular space, and then we get our primary filtrate or glomerular filtrate here, which is passing through the PCT, from where the tubular selective reabsorption begins. First, from in the PCT, all the solid materials, all molecular structures like the glucose, amino acids, they are actively transported back into the blood capillaries, and then with the passive movement, the water and other materials, they get transferred from the convoluted tubule lumen to the outside capillaries, and subsequently in the third stage of the urine formation, in the process of tubular secretion, all those materials which cannot filter through the glomerular capillaries, they are actively transported into the distal convoluted tubule. And finally, the processed fluid, the urine, is collected in the collecting duct. So these are the three different steps: ultrafiltration, the glomerular filtration process, tubular selective reabsorption, and tubular secretion are the three different physiological steps of urine formation in rabbit. Besides excretion, kidney also regulates the volume of body fluid, blood and water, and hence it also work as an osmoregulatory organ, maintaining the homeostatic volume of the body. So that is the detailed process of urine formation in the kidney of rabbit. However, kidneys are not the only organ which carries out the process of excretion. There are some secondary organs are also present, but we do not consider them as the part of the excretory system, as they are not exclusively working to remove the waste products from the body. Rather, their primary functions are different, but apart from their primary functions, they also work as secondary excretory organs. So these organs, for example, lungs remove carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is also a byproduct waste of metabolic processes, which is needed to be removed from the body. And during the exhalation process of breathing, lungs remove the carbon dioxide. Hence, we can say lungs are also working as an excretory organ. Some amount of water is removed in the form of water vapor, which is present in the exhalating air, and some salt and some amount of water is also lost from the mammalian sweat glands, from the sweat glands of all mammals, including rabbit, which is also a part of excretion or removal of the waste from the body. Bile salts and bile pigments, which are removed by the alimentary canal in the process of ejection or defecation, which are produced in the liver, they are also the excretory products. Hence, all these organs, alimentary canal, lungs, sweat gland, all these act as the secondary excretory organ. So this is the detailed process of excretion in rabbit. In order to know about the structural organization, please consult my first video, Excretory System of Rabbit Part 1. For this video lecture, I have used two different books. First book, Modern Textbook of Zoology, Vertebrates by R.L. Kotpal, and second book, Chordate Zoology by P.S. Verma. All the images which I have used in this video lecture are downloaded from Google Images. Thank you.